I guess, congrats, guys. You finally made it to the core logic of hidden substation, control valve. So how do we control the valve? It's actually quite simple. Take ambient temperature value, run it through temperature graph function, and you will get supply water temperature set point. Compare it to measured value of supply water temperature. If the measured value lower than the set point, you open the valve. If it's higher, then you close it. Usually, if it's about these kind of tasks with set point and actual value, PID controller is used. Let's go to the software. In Automation Builder, the same way you did before, create a program and call it in PLC-PRG. As a first step, call temperature graph function. Then create local variables for T1 and T2. Start connecting inputs outputs to the function. First ambient temperature and then T1 and T2 variables. Now add a box and find in util library controller section. We could have used PID block, but we'll use PD instead, the one without integral part. We will still have integral part, but implemented in a different way. You will see it later. Okay, instance of the function block is in place. It's time to figure out what to attach to which input. Input actual, here goes supply water temperature value. Set point. As mentioned before, here goes T1 value, which is calculated above. KP, proportional gain of the controller. If you have a look at the formula which PD function blocks is based on, you will see that proportional gain is multiplied by an error, which in turn is a difference between set point and actual value. There's also derivative component, but we will not be using it here. Proportional gain, as other settings parameters, is stored in the persistent settings list. Grab it and drag it to the valve control program and connect to the respective input of the function block. TV input is not used in our case. What we need to do next is to specify range in which output Y is going to change. Min would be 0 and max would be 100%. P controller doesn't need to run all the time. If you think about it, if there is no pumps which push heated water to the consumer, there is no point in regulating the temperature. So let's bring in automod switch inputs for circulation pumps 1 and 2. Invert both inputs, combine them with AND operator, and connect to reset input. What reset input does is it replaces output Y with Y offset input value. Therefore, to the input Y offset, you connect replacement value in case system is not ready, which is 0. Okay, now we have percentage value of how much valve should be opened. And at the same time, we have two discrete commands, open and close the valve. How to connect them? Well, there are different ways. Ideally would be to have a valve which takes analog input as a position set point, but it is what it is. If you know the full range maneuvering time of the valve, then you can ensure that the valve is open to 100% by giving open command for maneuvering time interval. And then, if you need valve to be 70% opened, you give close command for 30% of maneuvering interval. So you keep track of valve position and move it by giving open or close pulses with calculated duration. Another way to control the valve would be to use position set point as an opening-closing rate. In other words, it is called pulse duration modulation, or if you have VSD background, pulse width modulation. If you take pulse period, let's say 10 seconds, and output of P controller as a duty cycle, with controller output 25, you'll get on signal for 2.5 seconds and then off for 7.5 seconds. And then everything will repeat again. If duty cycle is 100, then signal is always on. If 0, then always off. I think you get the idea. Then we just need to create another function block. It'll take enable, duty cycle, and cycle time as inputs. There will be only one output where the pulses is actually generated. you would need two TP timers, one for on state and another one for off state, and two variables to calculate on and off time of the cycle. First, you limit duty cycle input to range 0 to 100, then convert it to range 0 to 1, multiply with cycle time, and assign to on time variable. Don't forget conversion from and to time data type. To get off time value, just subtract cycle time with on time. And then call two timers. Enable inputs of timers are interlocked with inversed outputs of other timer. This way, after on interval, will follow off interval, and then on again, and cycle will continue until enabled input is true. Good. Call a function log instance and connect duty input to the output of P controller. Cycle time comes from a variable in the persistent settings list. Output of PWM goes directly into the valve open discrete output. And to enable pulse generation, you can use the same condition as for the P controller. Let's see how it works. Go to simulation mode, add supply water temperature input to the watch list, put both pumps into automatic mode, set supply water temperature to 45, and yeah, I messed up with PWM enable input. Get out of simulation and remove inversion from auto inputs. Try it again, and now it looks like something is going on. With duty cycle 50%, you get 5 seconds pulse followed by 5 seconds delay. If you bring temperature closer to the set point, like 54 degrees, you'll get only 5% duration pulse, which is 500 milliseconds. Okay, it's nice and everything, but I see two problems here. At the moment, there is no way to close the valve if temperature value goes above set point. Let's say you have 56 degrees, output is zero and nothing is really happening. Another problem is actual value will almost never reach exact set point value. It will always be dancing around set point, which in turn means that PWM will always generate small pulses. In the long run, it will lead to wearing out valve's mechanical components and relays in control circuits. So naturally, we want to avoid it by introducing some kind of neutral zone of P controller, where no output value will be generated. In control theory, it is usually called dead band or dead zone. We could have done this function ourselves. There is nothing complicated inside. But it's not always will be the case. Sometimes, instead of inventing a wheel, it's better to concentrate on important part. And by wheel here, I mean external open source libraries. The most prominent example of which is Open Source Community for Automation Technology, or OSCAT in short. You can go on their website and explore it yourself, but for now we will need only their OSCAT basic library. You can get it from OSCAT.de website or from Codesys store. I prefer this second option. Download OSCAT basic package file, go back to Automation Builder and close the project without closing the software itself. Then go to Tools, Package Manager, click Install and select previously downloaded file. Once you've done it, you'll see OSCAT Basic in the list of installed packages. If you go to Details and then Installation Log, you'll see where the library is installed. Along with library itself, in that location you will find Library Manual. Open the manual and only by looking at the table of content, you can already see how massive this library is. Function we're after is called deadZone. So you have variable x as an input and variable deadZone as an output. If x is within plus minus L range, then output is not changed and remains zero. Perfect, let's put it to use. Go back to Automation Builder. Go to Library Manager and add OSCAT Basic to the project. Blue icon indicates availability of library's source code. Now place dead zone function call between pcontroller and pwm function block. Parameter from persistent list comes to L input. Let's see how it works in simulator. Duty cycle value 5% is passed from input to the output. If we make it 2.5%, then only 0 goes to PWM. What about the first problem? How to make pcontroller close the valve? Well, you can't do it. Just kidding. You will need another controller which will handle closing of the valve. The only difference will be the sign of proportional gain. To invert the controller, you need to invert the sign of the KP. And of course, you need to create another instance for PD controller and PWM function block. Output of the PWM close is connected to the valve close variable. Test it one more time. Temperature is 55 degrees. Nothing is happening as expected. 55.5 degrees. Close controller gives output, but it's smaller than dead zone value. 57 degrees. Yeah, the valve starts to close. Even though we have managed to debug the application as it is, sometimes it's useful to present processes graphically by plotting variable graphs over time. It is especially the case with fast-flowing processes. What if I told you it is easily doable inside Automation Builder? Let me show you how. We go Application, add Object from the context menu, scroll down and find Trace item. Give it a task to be synced with and a name. Now add a variable which you want to be plotted on the graph. Open valve discrete output. Give it a color, let's say red, then close valve with bluish color, then check configuration of the trace object. You can make it work all the time if you leave it as it is now, or create some trigger which starts trace recording. In advanced settings, you can set how often value must be recorded. We probably don't need to record it each cycle, every 100 milliseconds should be fine. It gives us 16 plus minutes of recording buffer, more than enough. Log in to the simulation again, arrange windows, prepare values, start the PLC, and then important part is to click load trace to target. Something is happening, but it's scrolling too fast. Click multiple times, compress X-axis, or you can do the same by mouse scroll with Alt button pressed. Control and mouse scroll will do the zoom on Y-axis. It's much easier to understand what's going on if you have this graph representation of the process. Change the temperature to 50 degrees, red pulses get slimmer. And now you see how the valve itself integrates the control signal over time. Each pulse opens it ever so slightly, but over a long period, those little movements are added up into fully opened or fully closed valve. Put the value in a dead zone, and indeed no pulses are generated. Now engage valve closing signal. Yeah, blue pulses appears on the graph. Rise the supply temperature even more. Now close pulses has longer duration. What the hell? What is this spike? Where does it come from? Valve is not supposed to open, only to close. We must try to reproduce this again. And here with a temperature 54.6, controller output is in a dead zone. And there should be no pulses, but yet again you can see open and close pulses, and then close once again. And the worst part, it's not consistent. Okay, stop the simulation and zoom into the part of the graph with the spikes. It seems like the value goes to true only for one cycle, and then gets back to where it's supposed to be. Let's go to PWM and try to figure out what might be the problem. And you know what? I have an idea what it could be. Even if timer is zero, it still needs at least one cycle to switch off and then on again. Let's try to prove this theory. Go to trace settings and increase resolution so we get a value each cycle. Go online, put the trace on the same page, pumps to auto, start the PLC. Make actual value equal to the set point. Now load the trace, zoom out. Yeah, here are our guys. Each 10 seconds we have a spike for exactly one cycle. Good, at least we know what to fix. Probably the best solution would be to rewrite the PWM function block completely without using standard timers. By using, let's say, only system time tick counter. Or since we only have the problem when duty cycle is 0 or 100, let's handle those conditions separately. When duty cycle is 0, then force output to false. When duty cycle is 100, force it to true. Try it out. Duty cycle is 100, all seems to be okay. No spikes at close valve output. Duty cycle is 25. Good, nice and clean pulse. Now temperature reaches the set point. No pulses and no spikes. And the last test, temperature overshoot. Clean pulses on closed valve output. As you can see, often it's not enough to have an error-free build and seemingly right behavior of logic. Sometimes problem will only appear if you observe control system in dynamics. Thankfully, we have tools to tackle those problems. Thanks for watching. Till the next one.